Uniform Papa 728, San Diego departure radar contact. Uniform Papa 728, climb and maintain 4,000. Uniform Papa 728, disregard that turn right heading 270. Uniform Papa 02, North Island weather 800 scattered, estimated 1,200 overcast, visibility 5, light drizzle and fog, and the altimeter is 2992.
Departure King Air 5, Victor Golf is with you, heading 295, and we're climbing through 900 feet.
69 Tango, climbing 340, climbing, maintain 9,000.
Roger, out of 2.5 for 9,000.
Lillia Papa Papa, contact Lindbergh Tower 133.3.
There are those who consider these supersonic times the calm and peaceful days of flying. They are and they are not. There have been other days, much simpler, more immoderate, and infinitely more joyful for those whose very life and love was flight.
The people today are taught techniques, they're taught to be a technician. They're not taught to be a flyer as we used to know in the old days. We used to refer to pilots and flyers. Now, a flyer was the guy that would put an airplane on and just go. He didn't worry about whether the wheel was turned this way or the rudder was that way.
He went by the feel of the airplane.
He went by the feel. This was flying, and you were a flyer. The guy that had to get up there and turn to page 46 in the book to get the answer on what he's going to do next was a pilot. The flyers of the old days were artists. And so help me, if I were a young man today, I wouldn't be interested.
Mom?
I'm interested in the art that we used to have, where you go out there and, yeah, you feel the air. You listen to the wires. And you smell the oil. It's all part of something, and you're a part of it. It's what you make the airplane do. I think this is basically the difference between early aviation and the aviation of today.
It bored me to death to fly on an airline now because it's more or less a push-button deal. It's got to have a sticker, a wheel, and rudders and stuff for me.
You talk to any old-timer, and he will tell you that the thrill of flying is in the old open cockpit planes. No one goggles an open cockpit, and that's the thing. To fly in those things, they really appreciate that.
Very pleasant, yeah. And the wind blowing in your face and everything like that, I really enjoyed that. That's one thing that I really like. More so in the cabin, though. Now, of course, there's got to be a cabin, see.
I fell in love with it, and it was the first time that I'd ever really experienced the sensation of the plane and me becoming as one. It seemed like the plane was a part of me and I was a part of the plane. We became a team, and that sensation grew.
It was wonderful to fly in those days because there are not enough airplanes in the air to hazard anybody. You never heard of airplanes colliding. The fact that you were up there and you're just as free as a bird, and you just felt like a bird.
When we flew cross country, we'd have to come down and look at the name on railroad stations and that to know where we were at.
Going to fly in the Jenny, that's that OX-5 biplane that was so famous for a training plane during World War I and thereafter. And many of those planes that had never been out of the crates were bought for a pittance, mainly around $500 or so, in new condition. And even they didn't even need cover. Just assembled and tinkered up a little and test flown and then used. And they were very famous barnstorming planes, but there were literally hundreds and hundreds of those things took the air shortly after World War I. And then, of course, they were used extensively by flying schools because they were so available.
Two generations were changing places when the old hard-bitten barnstormer was commencing his decline into almost total obscurity. Even though many had trained to fight the First World War in the air, few people honored them, and almost no one in aviation realized the relative scarcity of their numbers.
In America, for one successful Rickenbacker or Reed Chambers, there were hundreds of ex-World War I pilots still trying to scratch a living from the skies in any way they could.
They shipped me to San Diego and sent me to North Island, Naval Air Station. Chief machinist man, they came a chief, and then when the war ended, they gave me flight instructions and made me a naval aviator. And then I bought Curtis Jenny, the pioneer plane of aviation. The old Jenny is a thing I feel is that really made aviation. I'd barnstormed and not Jenny for 9 years, and I paid $300 for it. At the end of the 9 years, I sold it for $900. I barnstormed the southwestern states, like New Mexico, Arizona, Nevada, and California, Southern California. I had a wingwalker that would put a couple of wire loops up in the center section, up on the top wing, and he'd put his toes in those loops and hold his arms up like this, and I'd do vertical banks with him and land with him standing up there. He would fly over a little village and do some acrobatics, and we'd either land in the schoolyard or sagebrush or in the farmer's field as near as we could get to the town. And that would, of course, our exhibition over the town would attract the people, and they'd come out, and he would sell rides, and I'd take the people up $5 a ride.
And they said, well, we just want you to get out of the cockpit and just stand there, you know. Now, that's all we want you to do for the first time. And I did that, and, of course, you get the blast from the propeller, and maybe that would scare a lot of them. But, of course, as I don't know, it seems so I wasn't afraid of anything. He wanted me to come back in, but instead of that, I walked to the end of the wing. And I stood down there, and I looked at all the people down there kind of watching me, you know. And I stood there, and I waved at them. It was just wonderful most of the time. And all kinds of stunts. I stood on my head from the top, and I hung by my toes. And I, at the position I was at there now, I had my hand on the wing skid, and I used to do a 15-foot drop. And then I let go of this cable that I dropped with, which was attached to about the middle of the lower wing. And as I got to the bottom, let go with my hands, and I hung by my teeth. And then I'd done some tricks on the rope ladder, too, while I was hanging there, my one ankle and my knees, and also then standing on the top of the plane while it looped the loop. That was the finale of our act. I just loved it. I just loved it. I don't know, I really did enjoy it. I had no fear whatever of it. I didn't think, I thought, well, I was very much of a fatalist. I always thought, well, when my time comes, I'm going to go, regardless of whether I'm up in the air or where I was at. I always thought, well, that was like deadly poison. One drop will kill you.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Where did you learn to fly? Here in San Diego?
At North Island was where I learned to fly. And then they had some tests of an airplane there that it was a very dangerous airplane. Many Navy people got killed on flying that same type. They sold them off then, and I said, sure, I'll fly that darn thing. I did, and I got away with it. But I'll tell you, I wouldn't do it again. It was too much. Finally, in 1925, I started a tour of the United States from San Diego to New York. Of course, on the way, I had some engine trouble. Then, of course, when I was there, they had lots and lots of airplanes there. See, on Roosevelt Field, which is right next to Mitchell, where they're having the air races. So I decided to get out of there. It got real cold. So I got back into Pennsylvania, and it was snowing. And I didn't have a compass with me, so I was following the railroads. And I come to one place there in the snowstorm, and I noticed it come to an end that went through a tunnel. So I had to do a flip to get back and find a bunch of other railroads. Finally got through. So I did pretty well on that, and when I got back to San Diego,
I had covered 30-some states with an OX-5 Jenny, and we carried passengers all the way over and all the way back, and taken people hundreds of hours. Mm-hmm. And I never had a bit of trouble other than that engine. I couldn't seem to get it fixed.
Did you take them up for 5 hours a ride or something?
Less than that, $1.
$1.
I had more passengers that way, too. And then, of course, people would want to go from here to the next town. So I'd take them on that, and I'd do a little bit more. And so those are just some of the things that you run into in deals like this in the early days, anyway. And there's very few airports at that time.
And I recall one time I was going to Los Angeles from here, and I got up on the Oceanside, and then I decided I need gas in the service station just the other side of Oceanside, and I landed and gassed up there at that service station.
It's regular gas.
Yeah. I remember one time we were trying to go into Nevada to do some barnstorming. I got San Bernardino in a real heavy windstorm, north windstorm. And I kept climbing, thought I could get above the wind. And I finally got up around, and I had a swing walker in front of me in the front cockpit. I got up around 22,000 feet, and I noticed his head had flopped over. And he had run out of gas, out of oxygen. So I dove it right down right quick, and I was getting kind of weak myself trying to get over this windstorm, and decided I would land under a ridge on a plateau that came down from the ridge, and wait until the wind died down. I landed, and he jumped out and grabbed the tail, and we turned it around, tail into the wind, and the rocks were stinging our ankles, it was blowing so hard. So we decided that finally the wind wasn't going to die down, so we finally took off and come back from San Bernardino in 20 minutes to San Diego in that tailwind. That's how hard it was blowing.
And I landed in some of the nicest places I've ever seen, see. And landed in baseball parks, and I've landed in going with the wind, going uphill. And so I could take off going down the hill, see, against the wind. And so I never had any trouble. In 1925, I'd have to start out at night, never been to the next town, not flying to the next town looking for a landing field. At night, I'd been there many times. Finally, I got to realizing that I might get some kind of way, don't have a landing field.
I'd try to go just as high as the thing would go, and you get up there, and you go someplace, and you think, my God, am I ever going to find a way home? You'd be in strange country, you know, country that you knew where you were in a way, but you knew where home was, but it's an awful long ways, and it's a darn lonesome up there when you're up high, and all you hear is the sound of the engine and all this, but the thing of it is, you're just as free as a bird, and you just could go anywhere. It didn't bother you, you figured you could land anywhere. I could practically land that little old place, that little old job anywhere.
I had an accident and wiped out my airplane, and total loss in it. I landed in the jungle on the Colorado River on my return flight from the visit to San Diego. And that what caused the crash was that when I was between Blythe and Parker, I reached up and turned a valve to let the gas run out of the center section reserve tank in the main tank. And apparently they had let water get into that center section tank. And they found water in the carburetor, and that's what caused the crash. One of my passengers was killed, and the other guy was unconscious. And I broke both my arms and three ribs.
But that didn't keep you out of airplanes?
Oh, no.
The other side of Lake Pepin is a huge bluff. Must be at least 500 foot high. And, of course, I went up there, and there was a nice, looked like to me, an alfalfa field. So I proceeded to land. And as I did, a fellow would come out of his house, you know, pulling his hair. Said, "My golly," he says, "you know what you did?" "No, what did I do?" He said, you just thrashed 50 bushels of my prize clover. I said, and I didn't have any money with me to speak of, so I said, well, I'll be glad to pay you for it. He said, no, no, get the hell out of here. See? So I started up the engine, and I taxied out to the end of the field, and I thrashed another 50 bushels. But I tell you one thing, well, I was sure glad to get out of there.
I was just about over what would be Marston Museum. I was over about 2,000 feet, I guess. I had gone over town, and then I'd come over Hillcrest here, and then I flew over there. I thought, well, I'm going to see how this thing glides. So I pulled the throttle back slowly, and of course the motor engine kept turning over with the wind, see? And by golly, when I opened her up, I didn't have any engine. She didn't start going. So I don't know whether I closed the throttle or I don't remember, but I know that I went for maybe a quarter of a mile, and I was headed for Dutch Flats, which was probably a mile ahead, and there's a power line standing, a big high-tension power line right about level with me, and I had fury on that, so I just kicked a right rudder and pulled a stick over, and I just went down like this, see, and I made the best landing I'd made. I didn't make as good a landing for 6 months after that as I did there.
And sometimes we had to sleep under the wings at night, just get under the wing. And
say, you didn't make a lot of money with your plane,
I didn't make any. I didn't make any money. I just made, didn't even make expenses. I had to sleep on the ground some nights under the plane.
But you enjoyed every minute of it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I did it for the fun. And, the money I took in just helped pay the expenses.
Yeah, before that, then, I never even had a place to hang my hat. For years and years, just touring the country, living with people, doing things, and always designing something, made up my own engine. And it took me about 6 months to complete the airplane and the engine. And that turned out to be a fantastic flying machine.
Part of the time when I was here, I went to work in a garage as troubleshooter and foreman in that garage, and I'd fly out at Rolando on the weekends. And the airplane got to where it needed some work done on it, so I tore it down and took it and put it in the backyard of this garage and recovered it, and they overhauled the engine right there in the garage.
The pilot wasn't just a pilot, he was a mechanic.
He was a mechanic, yes, had to do all his own repair work. There was no mechanics around to do it.
The plane was assembled and built in a garage close by, and at this time we had a two-cylinder Harley Davidson motorcycle motor in it, which proved to have too much vibration on it, and as a result we shifted to a four-cylinder Henderson motorcycle motor. The fuselage was welded together, and that was all. Now, after I had made my arrangements with him, we moved that fuselage to the garage in South Pasadena, and there we finished it. Well, I flew it twice, but I was lucky the first time. The second time I cracked up because we had the angle of incidence apparently was wrong. It had it set at zero. And I noticed the first time I was flying the thing that the darn thing was mushing, you know, instead of free flight, it was kind of mushing. And after some difficulty, well, I brought it down. I should never have taken it up a second time, really.
Minor work and maintenance work I did myself. But later years, when I needed a, like for instance, my PT-26, Fairchild monoplane, I, rather than to try to overhaul it myself, I just bought a rebuilt engine and traded the old one in on it. And it was much easier and cheaper to do than to try to rebuild it myself.
This aircraft, when they put ran the test on us, they found that it needed both a very long runway for to get airborne and similarly to make a safe landing. And Jack Reed was the test pilot, And he took the aircraft up alone. He managed to get off the ground safely, although there wasn't much of a runway there. And it flew around for a while and landed. And when he got out of the aircraft, he came over to George Pruden, who was talking with a bunch of newspaper men, and he shook hands with George Pruden. He said, "A mighty fine ship, Mr. Pruden." And having said that, he quietly walked up to a few of us that were over there, out there from the factory, and out of hearing of the group, and he said, "Boys," he says, "she has the gliding angle of a brick."
We've been having stories in the paper, teasers, about a new bombing group coming to San Diego, assigned to Rockwell Field. These are new type airplanes called Keystone Bombers. And they were biplanes, and of course in those days no retractable landing gear. So when they finally came in, there was about 20 of them, and they come in on what they called bombing formation, which was single file, and they flew low over the city. They went up North Park and flew housetop level all around and scared the living daylights out of half the population. And as a last course before going over to Rockwell and landing, I got off working that day. It was at 3 o'clock in the afternoon at daytime. This was in the 30s. And I got off work. I was waiting for a streetcar down on Broadway. And I looks up Broadway Hill there, and here comes these planes. And they were flying down low down the hill just like it is on the ground. And they leveled off and went straight down Broadway, and they bounced their wheels, those wheels on their planes, on the trolley wires, and they had the wires bouncing up and down like this. The poles are going like this, the length of Broadway from about 10th Avenue through down to the bay. They were playing follow the leader. Whatever the first one did, the next one do the same thing. So, you might know, when they got to Rockwell, they were all grounded. Just imagine a thing like that happening today.
I was headed a little south of west, and at that time, on Point Loma, there was a golf club up there. And I was south of the golf club building, and going over the top, and there's a golf links below me. And there was a bunch of guys down there, and I wasn't getting any elevation. I felt that I didn't have the guts in the machine to lift it up. And here I was, and the ground was coming up at me. I looked down and I saw that thing was on battery. So I just quick flipped that up, and that thing just jumped into here, see. Well, I just flew over about four or five guys on the place, and they all just hit the deck like that. See, I was only about 15 feet over their head. I was just figuring I'm going to have to ditch this thing down here in a carrot patch beyond the down in the hole there, see. And then I got back my power, and then I flew around and took off to go back, and that was that kind of a hairy thing. And the funny thing about it was that one of these fellas was the head of the reserve gang down here, Lieutenant Stillinger. And he said, we were at a meeting, officers' meeting, and he said, well, there were a bunch of us out playing golf Sunday, and he said, some damn fool came off of there of Ryan's Field or Thomas Moore Scout. He says, he just about clipped us. And he said, he just went over the top of the hill, and he said, we just hit the ground like that. And I says, well, you knew the damn fool was. That was me.
We were a big family, and we had several brothers and several sisters. And, of course, when the young aviators came here, why, they were always having parties and getting together. And so, at one party, they asked Glenn what time he got up in the morning. Well, he said, I got up at 5:30. Well, he said, in a joking way, they said, well, why don't you come over for breakfast? Well, he said, I think that's a good idea. So he got on his airplane in North Island, flew over, and landed right from the house right here. He came here for breakfast. He had a good time. He got back on the on his plane and flew to North Island.
Well, I wonder if that could be done today. I doubt it.
All of these things were true only a few years ago. Some of those who have survived and are still flying are sometimes appalled at the swiftness of aeronautical change. Most of it has been for the good if you are willing to accept crowded skies and ever-lessening romance. Passenger or pilot, better off or not, flying is no longer a gypsy-like, adventure-promising way of life, and never will be again.
I think that they had to know more then than they do now. Now they rely on all these instruments and everything. Then they had to rely on their own brains, to my estimation. I think that they were better pilots then than they are now. You had to be a good pilot for somebody to walk around on the wings like that anyway, you know. Nowadays, I look at it, it makes me laugh. They put all this framework around them now, you know, before they make them loop-de-loop. I said, I'll get up there and do that today if they put all that framework around me.
When I first started flying, we didn't have the federal control. It was the city. Mm-hmm. My first license was a city license. And I flew on a city license even after the federal took over for about a year and a half. Otherwise, I could have had probably number one if I'd have jumped in there.
Long swimming days are over, yes, that's right.
The one thing that really amuses me is I go to some of these here antique air shows, and they're there with 1938 and 40 airplanes, and they call them antiques.
Right.
And as far as I'm concerned, they're practically new.
There's no
barnstorming today. Unless it's in where they're having an antique air show or something like that, you might be on the edge of barnstorming, taking people up for a ride at an air show. But that's about all I'm up to now. In fact, I didn't think too much about making money when I was flying. I was doing it for fun, mostly.
My flying career wasn't anything you could brag about. But I had a lot of fun.
And of course, I'd be raring to fly right now, but there's no fun anymore. They've taken all the fun out of it. Too highly regulated, and you're tied down too much with regulations. Can't go out and chase the jackrabbits and the coyotes and wave at the engineer on the train and people and drive along in their cars on the highway and land above the highway at a service station and gas up anymore. You can't do that.
People that I know that are flying, they enjoy it very much, just the same as I did. But of course, they don't know how free and easy it was in the days that I was flying.